Welcome back to the classroom. We are taking up AS-11, effects of changes in foreign exchange rates. Okay, before I move to AS-11, I just wanted to clarify two things regarding the topic which we took yesterday on government grants. One of them, I started talking yesterday about something called as general grants. Wherein I was told that there is no general grants which are received by the government or from the government. Okay, later on through the questions, and a few people had come to me after the class and had asked a few questions. On the basis of that, I realized that there are certain institutes which are receiving grants which are general or in the nature of promoter's contribution. Okay, I had skipped that part because, as I said, when I started the session, I was told that there is no general grants, there are only specific things. Now, let me cover that general grant or promoter contribution part in next 5 minutes, okay, and I'll wrap it up. Now, yesterday there was a question which was, suppose I incur 100 rupees as expense during the year, and 10 rupees is what I receive as income during the year. Okay, so my net deficit is 90 rupees. That net deficit is funded by the government as government grant, right? Now, how will you classify this grant as? Capital or revenue? 10 rupees is not a grant. 10 rupees is what you earn through your normal receipts from students or whatever activities you do throughout the year, right? 100 rupees is your expenditure for conducting those activities. 90 rupees is your deficit. That 90 rupees is funded by the government. Now, how will you classify this grant? Revenue grant, recurring grant. And where will you recognize this? As income and expenditure in income and expenditure account. If you do that, then your net deficit or surplus will become zero. Is that correct?
But yes, but not more that whatever revenue grant you are receiving, you should park it into the liability side part. And any expenditure is incurred, then you should debit the part and create the income.
Right. Right. And when we do that, when do we take it to expenditure? When we incur that expenditure. That means if I take. Right. So when I say that I have 100 rupees as expenditure, that means I have already incurred that expenditure of 100 rupees.
Yeah, yeah.
And if I have incurred that expenditure of 100 rupees, I will record that grant of 90 rupees and 10 rupees as my other income, my normal income. So my net surplus or deficit will become nil. I am asking, is that correct?
Yeah.
So my net income or expenditure is zero. Okay. As per accounting standard 12, what I was discussing, general grants, okay, these type of grants are grants in the nature of promoter's contribution. See, they are funding the deficit. When the government is funding the deficit, or when anyone, say take it as a normal private company, okay, a private company which is incurring a loss. Now, if they want to run that private company, they will require infusion of money. That infusion of money will come in the form of capital, right? Similarly, this 90 rupees, the deficit which is funded by the government, is also a form of capital, which is promoter's contribution. And hence, this should not go into income, this should be directly kept in your capital fund. So, a grant which is to fund a deficit, or which is in the nature of promoter's contribution, which is general in nature. See, when I say general, I understand that you must have pointed out that we have these expenditures, salary is this much, rent is this much, or whatever. You might have put down the expenditure, but they are not trying to fund specific expenditure, they are trying to fund a deficit, they are trying to fund the institute so that it can run generally. This type of grant is a promoter's contribution grant and should be taken to capital fund. It should not be taken to income. Your income.
If we are not taken to income, then in the expenditure statement there is a 100
deficit.
Rupees,
it will.
This statement would be.
Yes,
expenditure over income. Income.
So basically, my income and expenditure account will show an expenditure of 100, income of 10, and a deficit of 90. This deficit of 90 will then go to my capital fund in the balance sheet. And my capital fund, I have received 90 from the government. This 90 will go over here as deficit. But my income and expenditure account should show a deficit. And because this type of grant is a grant of promoter's contribution, that is why it should not directly go to income. See, that's what I am saying. You have to differentiate between one revenue grant, capital grant. Capital grant can be for specific asset or it can be in form of promoter's contribution. Revenue grant is for revenue. Now, when I say a grant is in form of promoter's contribution, I explained now that if you are trying to fund a deficit, see, you are not giving grant for specific expenses. You are giving grant to fund a deficit. When you give grant to fund a deficit, it is a grant in the form of promoter's contribution.
Not mentioned in the government of grant, this is the your deficit amount of we are releasing. This is not mentioned in the government grant.
It's
grant paid to institute. This is the language used by the MHRD.
See, I am talking about principles. Okay. I am talking about accounting principles, all the logic, all the principles behind the standards. The standard says that when it is in form of promoter's contribution, when it is trying to fund a deficit, it should directly go to capital fund and should not be taken to income and expenditure account. When it is trying to grant, the grant is for a specific expenditure.
Sir, MHRD is given a grant for specific expenditure for salary component, non-salary component. See, there are specific instructions.
So I am saying there are certain institutes, you know, yes, over there. So, because there are various institutes over here, I was trying to cover problems or issues of each and every institute. So when an institute receives grants in the form of promoter's contribution, then this is the accounting treatment which should be followed.
But this is only for promoter's contribution which you are telling. But generally when grants are received from the government of India, it will always be specific. First it will be in two segments.
One is not applicable to all of us.
It is applicable to some of y'all who are there at the back, because I received a few questions yesterday at the end of the session. So I thought I'll clarify wherever it is applicable, because everyone might not have asked me the question.
But it cannot be generalized, because when we receive
absolutely
it is so, under revenue and capital.
See,
and
that's revenue. What I said. You have to classify a grant into two parts first. Okay? A capital grant and a revenue grant.
And revenue also, under revenue head there are specific heads like salary or...
So if you have classified it as revenue grant, we have discussed that you will take it to liability and from liability to income. If it is for a specific asset, we have discussed you will take it to deferred revenue and then to income. Okay, and there are certain institutes which receive it in form of promoter's contribution.
Sir, all the institutes are getting like that, sir.
In that case, it will directly
all
go to...
All the institutes are getting general development grant.
Okay, we'll talk about your institute. We'll not talk about all of them. But for your institute, if you are receiving anything in form of promoter's contribution, it will go directly to capital fund. It will not go to income and expenditure account.
Correct.
Clear? Okay. So let's move to AS-11. Effects of changes in foreign exchange rates. Now, this standard is basically applicable for two types of transactions, two types of issues. One is transactions happening in foreign currency and the other is foreign operations. Now, when I say foreign currency or foreign operations, what do I mean by foreign? What is a foreign currency?
US dollar.
Any currency which is not INR. Okay. Why INR? Because it's INR is my home currency. So any currency other than home currency. Okay. I'll tell you a basic difference between Indian accounting standards, which we'll discuss throughout this session, and the difference between Indian accounting standards and international accounting standards. Okay. International accounting standards do not define home currency as INR or USD. They do not define. They talk about logic, how to find out my home currency. Okay. If I ask you, in what language do you speak? Okay. Now, we are all Indians, but we have different language in which we speak. It can be Hindi, Marathi, English. It can be any different languages depending upon which state we come from or which background we come from, right? So, like there can be different languages, every business can deal in different currency. And the currency in which they primarily deal with becomes their home currency. So if a company is into imports and exports, okay, so if it imports from US, does some work, exports to US, so its primary currency might become USD, and that might become its home currency. That is how international standards talk about. Now, when we come to Indian accounting standards, it does not talk about what is your home currency. It simply states any currency other than INR is foreign currency. So, like you said, like you defined a foreign currency, any currency other than foreign INR is foreign currency. That's how the standards also define. Now, the standard talks about two things, as I said. One is a transaction which is in foreign currency or a foreign operation. Now, foreign operation means if I have a branch, a subsidiary, anything outside India. Now, is the second part relevant for us, foreign operations? I think no, right? So we will concentrate on the first part, which is any transaction in foreign currencies. Okay. Now, there are two principal issues which this standard deals with. One is the exchange rate which we should use to record the transactions. And when we use an exchange rate, there is an exchange difference which comes. So there is what exchange rate to use and how to account for the difference in exchange currency, the amount of difference. These are the two basic principles or basic issues which we'll deal with. So the scope is, as I said, accounting for transactions in foreign currencies, translating the foreign operations financial statements, and forward contracts. Now, I think forward contracts is also something which we which is not relevant from our point of view. So only the first part, which is foreign currency transactions, we'll deal with. Okay, now there can be four types of foreign currency transactions. The first is when you buy or sell normal goods in foreign currency. Second one is when you borrow or lend money in foreign currency. The third one is when you enter into a forward exchange contract. And the fourth one is when you buy or sell a fixed asset which is denominated in foreign currency. So goods or services, buy or sale, or fixed assets, buy or sale, or borrowing or lending, or foreign this forward contract. These are the four areas which this standard deals with. Okay, now what are the foreign currency transactions which you face in institutes? Okay, one is fees which you receive from foreign students. Then, okay, so consultancy expense, right? This is fees is receipt. Okay, consultancy income. So let's classify this as income. Fees, consultancy, donations you receive from foreign.
Yes.
Sorry? Foreign aided projects, let's take. Income, any other income is left? Royalties. Okay. Okay, let's talk about revenue expenditure and capital expenditure, okay. So, capital expenditure you said is any assets, equipments. Books you capitalize, right? So it is capital expenditure. Okay, journals or books, let it be together. Journals or books.
Sir, we export scientific equipment. Sir.
Sorry?
We import scientific equipment. Import scientific equipment.
Data analysis. So that is revenue expenditure for me.
So scientific equipment worth the process.
Scientific equipment, right. So assets import. Or equipment I have kept over here.
Chemicals.
Chemicals is revenue expenditure or capital? So this is kind of goods for me. Right? And this is services for me. Membership fees. Expenditure, right? Foreign visits, yes. So traveling is the word I'll put, yes. Okay, AMCs. Honorarium, yes. Honorarium, or let's also put it as consultancy fees if we are paying any. Okay, so these are the income, revenue expenditure and capital expenditure. Okay, now let's talk about the income first. Now, when do you earn the income? When you earn the income, how do you recognize that income? Or how do you translate that income into Indian currency? Say suppose you have received fees of $10. Right? And you have received, now, there is a date when fees become payable by the students. There is a date when you receive the fees. Right? And there is a date or a period over which you recognize the fees. Is this the three ways or three times when you account for fees, right? When one is when you, when the fees become accrued, okay? One is when you fees is received, and the third is when the fees is spread over the period, okay? Now, $10, say suppose, what is the academic year like? I mean, for us it is, suppose 5 July, okay, so. Okay, then, on the same date, suppose, okay, so there is a DD of $10 on the same date, fine. So you have received $10, now, how do you convert? The conversion is whatever the bank gives. Whatever the bank credits are account, so fine, fees is simple. Okay, let's talk about consultancy income. Okay, say consultancy income is $10, right? Now, do you bill them?
No, $10. Suppose I receive and I don't deposit within 10 days or 5 days or something. How to record it? On which date?
Chalo, let's take that again. Say you deposit on 15th of July, rate here was 60.50, rate here is 61, okay, per USD, right, how do you recognize this transaction, at what rate? I'll answer that, let me take your views. Okay. 61.
Then the 50 paisa exchange gain that I have received, I will account for that also. I will credit the gain on foreign exchange and debit bank.
Everyone does this. I'll repeat what he said. 5th of July, when you receive the DD, that is the last date of making the payment, right? Now, you have received the DD, so this revenue of fees should be recorded based on $10, based on 60.50. Okay, that is my revenue from fees. When the DD is deposited in bank and bank gives you payment as per 61.
So there is a fluctuation gain of 50%.
The difference of 61 minus 60.50, 0.50, you have got extra. This into $10 will be recorded as other income, that is gain on fluctuation of foreign currency.
Foreign currency.
This is how you should account for this transaction. Yes.
Then I should not, I should recognize the income as soon as I have received the income.
You should recognize income as soon
on
as
accrual
you have
basis
received
of
the income.
Accounting.
In case of check receipt, $10 will have received. Yes, you are deposited to the bank. Yes, you can take when it will realize. That?
No. You can't. See, understand this. All these accounting entries, whatever we do, the net effect on profit and loss will be same. But we are not preparing profit and loss to calculate the profit. We give entire details of what is the income, what type of income it is, how did we earn it. So a proper presentation.
Suppose I have deposited on 31st March, then I have to book because on 31st March I will not get the credit. In the next financial year I will receive the credit. So I have to recognize my income.
So my proper presentation is I should record the income at 60.50 as fees and balance 0.50 should come as gain on foreign exchange fluctuation. Yes sir, your doubt. So you will have loss on foreign exchange transaction. So we'll record income at 60.50 and this is 60.
Loss on foreign exchange debit to bank.
Loss on foreign exchange.
Reduce that head.
You will not reduce the revenue head. You will book loss on foreign exchange fluctuation.
Separate disclosure is required. Loss
separate
or gain
disclosure
on foreign exchange.
Is mandatory. You have to disclose it separately as loss on foreign exchange fluctuation. Yes.
Recognize the revenue. If a student deposit online transfer on 5th July and the conference date is 15th July for that he has paid the fees, then the 15th July will be considered as relevant date for getting that.
5th July he has transferred and 15th July is?
15th July is the conference date for which he has deposited the fees. He has transferred online $10 on 5th July to attend a conference. Huh. The conference will be on 15th July.
What happens if the conference gets cancelled?
Then we have to refund that fees.
You have to refund the fees?
Yes, sir, exactly.
In that case, the income should be recorded on 15th of July when the conference happens.
Okay, sir.
So your income will be booked on 15th of July. Your receipt will be booked on 5th of July. So your entry is, suppose, you know, actually you are running ahead. We are talking about fees, but let's take this up. So you have received at the rate of 60.50 on 5th of July.
Yes, sir.
Your conference is on 15th of July. At that time, the rate is, say, 60 rupees.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, first of all, when you receive at 60.5, okay, what you have received is 605 rupees, right, into $10 I have done. So, 605 rupees, my entry will be bank account debit to liability of 605. On 15th of July,
yes, sir.
When I am booking the income, my entry would be it
liability,
is 60, right? So 600.
Debit. Liability
so,
debit to income account.
To gain on fluctuation. So this is 605, this is 600, this is 5. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Suppose it would have been reversed. Suppose this was 590. So there will be a loss on fluctuation of 10 rupees.
Yes, sir.
Clear?
Generally for foreign students, generally the fees are fixed in USD in some other currencies. So in that case, there is no point of any fluctuation because as and when it is getting realized, because $20 he has remitted, it is converted by the bank when the credit is given during e-transfer and other things. So there is no possibility of any…
No, so that's what I said. See, if 15th of July it is directly credited in bank. And 15th of July is what you have received. See, he's not talking about this consultancy thing. You're talking about the normal fees, right?
Normal
you're not talking about conference.
Yeah.
Huh. Normal fees, as I said in the first example which I took, that 15th of July is the last date. He deposited the check on 15th of July and I will get credit as per rate of exchange on 15th of July, then there is no foreign exchange fluctuations. No,
if it is denominated in foreign currency, because it, if it
yes,
is not denominated in Indian currency, if it is denominated in foreign currency, $20 we are saying
if,
per
if a foreign student gives Indian currency, then there is no foreign exchange fluctuations.
Naturally. No, no. Fine? If it is we are paying for Indian student 1000 rupees is a fee. We are doing in the advertisement itself for Indian students the fees is 1000 rupees. For foreign payments the fees is $20. So they are remitting $20 on various dates. Maybe 10th, 15th. We are giving a slab, not on a particular date. The period is given from 10th to 30th. Any time you can apply, maybe for the recruitment purpose. So what, whenever it is coming, bank is giving a credit at various with applying various different exchange rates, applying on the, it is fluctuating every day on day to day basis. So whatever is received we are accounting.
Okay, see, this is what the standard says should be done ideally. Then the standard also says that if there are a lot of transactions in foreign currency and there is not much fluctuation during the month, then you can take an average rate and apply that average rate for all the transactions during the month, or maybe 15 days, or you can take some period. Average rate can be applied to all the foreign transactions during that period, and you can go by that average rate for the sake of convenience. So if I have 15 transactions in a month, as you are saying, you know, I have a lot of checks which I receive from foreign students, I can apply an average rate for a period and I can go by that. You need not go by each transaction, what was the rate and all that stuff. Yes. I'll answer your question. Okay. So let's come back to this example wherein I have received at 60.50 on 5th of July. Okay. So on 5th of July I have passed this entry. Right, on 5th of July I have passed this entry. Now, on 15th of July, I realized that the conference has been cancelled. And on 15th of July, the rate has come to 60. So I have to refund back 600 rupees. Okay. In that case, what will happen is, this will not be income, this will be bank. And the remaining things remain same. And suppose this becomes 610, so there is a loss of 5 rupees, so loss on exchange of 5 rupees, clear?
When it's gain is okay, fine, but when it's loss, the same people will issue me a memo, and it's very difficult to make a mention, they should blame me for this loss, they will blame me.
Then you have to ask them to read accounting standard 11.
Same thing that where it is mentioned in your significant accounting policies that it's mentioned or not, AS-11 and all.
So you have to mention it in your significant accounting policies also that the income is recognized as per the rate existing on the date of transaction or average rate during that period.
But that's agreed, but they will again they will blame me only that you have done this late and delayed, that's why it's HM and it's on your part.
Sir, I can tell you what accounting standards say. Now government is forcing you or is wanting you to follow accrual basis system and follow accounting standards. When you follow accounting standards, you have to even teach CAG to follow the accounting standards. And this is what you will have to do. I mean, the entire system has to change. Yes.
In this case, conference has been cancelled from the institute. If the participant is... He didn't attend the conference or something, he didn't participate in the conference. We have to pay back the money. And that time, that foreign amount, it has gone up. And that time, we have to take that foreign gain or loss. That balancing amount, we have to take as a foreign gain or loss.
Yes.
But problem is that why we have to bear that loss? Because it is the problem from the participant end. And that time, we can pay the only the less amount. No?
See. The standard does not say that you pay 600 or 610 or 605. If you are paying them at a fixed rate, say you will pay, if you have received 605, you will pay them only 605. Then there is no foreign exchange gain or loss.
If it gone up, for example, one day it was 60 on 5th, and on 15th July it gone up to 610.
I understand. So whatever you pay over here, the balance will come over here. If you are paying 605, then the balance will be zero over here. Right? So if you say suppose my liability is to pay $10, because the foreign exchange has gone up, I am paying only $9.85. So I am settling my liability at $9.85. That's what you're doing, right? When you when the foreign exchange has gone up, but I am paying only 600 rupees, that means I am paying only $9.85, for example. I am not paying $10 back to him. If that's the case, I am settling my liability at a lower amount. So there is a gain because of settling the liability at lower amount, and there is a loss on foreign exchange which will get knocked out.
When we receive the amount, there is an account code. Under that 8 year, we are receiving all the income. So total accumulated income is there on one side.
Right.
Contract stands cancelled and we have to refund that. But the dollar rate has gone up. So we will be spending more amount.
Right.
From where to read and how to account for that?
No. What do you do currently?
No situation is not like that.
Then your question is invalid. You should ask someone where this.
It depends on the terms and condition of the participation.
Sir.
If income is received by converting the bank has converted the amount, then bank charges some bank charges plus service tax extra. We should deduct that amount from that fees, or and net amount should be booked in fees or bank charges.
Bank
should
charges
be
should go
deducted.
To bank charges.
And the gross fees will be booked as fees.
Yes.
Okay. The foreign currency received against as fees should be kept as foreign currency only till the conference is over.
No, see, this is not what the standard says. This is what you have to decide. See, there is two things. One is your operational aspect and your accounting aspect. Accounting standard can only guide on accounting aspects.
That means it is our discretion.
Operational aspects, yes, that is your discretion. If you keep it in dollars,
yes,
you can keep it in dollars. And then you have a foreign currency loss also and foreign currency gain also.
Gain
on your asset side, loss on your, and both will knock off. So your gain or loss account will have a nil balance.
Nil balance.
So that is your operational aspect. Yes, ma'am.
He has paid his exchange rate for $500. He has paid, but
right.
Our bank deducts from the Indian currency whatever it becomes equivalent. And the bank deducts its charges. Now, that charges, how is it to be treated in the account?
Okay. So let's take an example of this $10 at 60.50. So, I should have received 605 rupees. But then there is a bank charges of 15 rupees. So, I have received 590 rupees. Right? Okay. I should book revenue of 605. So, my entry will be bank account debit 590, bank charges account debit, which is my expenditure, 15 rupees to revenue 605 rupees. Fine?
So at the time of refund, the dollar rate goes to 60. Now, suppose there will be deficit, the refunding account, there will be no adequate funds available in that.
Sir, that is operational question. That is not accounting question. Okay. Now, how to meet that deficit, you have to decide operationally. Suppose there was no accounting standard 11, still there would be deficit. How will you meet the deficit that you have to decide? Accounting standards will tell you how to account for that. Right? So, you tell me how will you meet the deficit, I will tell you how to account for that. So then accounting is simple. Right.
Sir, जो मैंने जैसा आपसे conference का question पूछा था, उसमें conference में ये होता है कि उसका जो total accumulated profit होता है, उसका 20% 30% अलग-अलग institute का अलग-अलग norms है, वो उस professor को जाता है जो उस project को lead करता है।
हाँ।
तो अगर ये bank charges हम institute account में book कर देंगे, तो professor को extra share मिलेगा। उसका प्रॉफिट एग्जैक्ट नहीं निकलेगा कॉन्फ्रेंस का जो प्रॉफिट निकलना चाहिए फर्स्ट थिंग सेकंड थिंग ऐसे ही केस में अगर हम देखें कि हमने फॉरेन से कोई इक्विपमेंट परचेस किया है 10 लाख का है
फॉरेन इक्विपमेंट पे मैं आऊंगा सर आई हैव लिस्टेड आई हैव कवर्ड ऑल ऑफ
चार्जेस इक्विपमेंट के कॉस्ट में ऐड करते हैं
सर आई विल कवर ऑल ऑफ देम don't worry. So foreign equipment pe main aata hu. Let's talk about the fees or you know the income part first. Let's talk about.
So फिर वो conference fees का profit गलत निकलेगा ना उसका extra share professor को मिलेगा. तो वो तो institute के main fund में से deduct हो जाएगा.
Bank charges भी आप वो project या वो conference के charges में आप डालिए. Conference का जब PNL बनाएंगे या income and expenditure account बनाएंगे.
तो फिर यहीं पे fees net से book कर सकते हैं ना bank charges deduct करके.
See. मैं काम क्यों नहीं करता हूँ मैं इनकम एंड एक्सपेंडिचर इतना बड़ा क्यों बनाता हूँ दो ही लाइन का बनाऊँ मैं नेट इनकम नेट एक्सपेंडिचर नेट सरप्लस
तो फिर वो बैंक चार्जेस से जेवी सिंपल ना
मेरे को 15 लाइन का मतलब मैं फुल पेज का इनकम एंड एक्सपेंडिचर बनाता हूँ जरूरत क्या सब कुछ नेट कर दो सीधा नेट सरप्लस आ गया
नहीं सर अगर फिर ऐसा करेंगे तो फिर उसका जो फॉरेन एक्सचेंज का गेन और लॉस है उसमें भी चेंज आएगा अगर बैंक चार्जेस
आएगा ही सी व्हाट इज माई रेवेन्यू 605 रुपीज What is my expenditure? 15 is my expenditure. Net, I am not, he is not paying me net revenue. If I bill him, I will be billing him for $10. He will be paying me 605 rupees. Bank ne beech mein charges laga diya. So that is not my net income. Bank charges will go to bank charges. Like gain or loss on foreign exchange fluctuation will go to gain or loss on
after
foreign
that,
why don't I net off
that,
gain or loss with the income? I am not netting off gain or loss with the
after
income.
After that,
right?
We will transfer that bank charges amount to that particular Conference account?
Yes, why not?
Okay.
Conference ka income and expenditure banayenge, tab usme debit kar do. Yes, sir.
Maine kaha jab aapko ek baar receipt hua,
haan.
5 July ko,
haan.
Tab aapne foreign currency ko convert kar diya Indian rupees mein.
Right.
Then 15 tarikh ko aapki conference ka due kiya aapne.
Haan.
To kya us time bhi conversion ko aap consider karenge?
Ek second. See, आपको ये समझना है कि आप इनकम कब बुक करें 15 तारीख या 5 तारीख अभी अपने केस में 15 तारीख को इनकम बुक हो
सर मैटर तो फॉरेन करेंसी कन्वर्जन का है ना
उसके लिए आपको ट्रांजैक्शन कब हो रहा है टाइमिंग ऑफ ट्रांजैक्शन इज इम्पोर्टेंट
सर जो एक्चुअल में जो रिसीव नहीं होगा बैंक के अंदर वो प्रॉफिट क्रिएट करने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं
सी आपने अर्न तो तभी किया है जब वो इनकम बुक किया है
सर मैटर ओनली है ना टू कन्वर्जन ऑफ फॉरेन करेंसी है ना सर तो वो एट द टाइम ऑफ रिसिप्ट या पेमेंट उसी टाइम होना चाहिए ना जेवी के टाइम भी थोड़ी ना होगा
जेवी के टाइम होगा सी अंडरस्टैंड दिस ट्रांजैक्शन कब बुक करेंगे 15 रेवेन्यू इनकम कब बुक करेंगे 15 तारीख को
सर मैटर मैं यही कह रहा था दो चीजों को डिफरेंशिएट नहीं किया
अब मेरी पूरी बात समझिए इनकम कब बुक करेंगे
इनकम तो 15 जुलाई को
15 तारीख को बुक करेंगे जब इनकम बुक करेंगे तब मैं AS-9 फॉलो करूंगा बरोबर AS-9 क्या यू हैव टू मेजर आपको क्या मिला है उसको आप मेजर करेंगे
लेकिन सर मेरी इंडियन रुपी
आप पूरी बात सुनिए जब AS-9 क्या बोलता है मुझे क्या मिला मैं उसको मेजर करूंगा
हाँ हाँ
मुझे क्या मिला $10 मिला कि 605 रुपया मिला
सर 605 रुपये मिल गया ना मुझे
मुझे
5 जुलाई को
मुझे $10 मिला है
सर 5 जुलाई को मुझे 605 रुपये मिल चुका है
मुझे $10 मिला है
सर यही कह रहा हूँ सर डिफरेंट है दोनों तारीख को मेरे पास 605 रुपए थे ऑलरेडी जो रिसीव हो चुके हैं 5 जुलाई को
आपने सामने वाले से 600 रुपया मांगा या $10
मांगा $10 मांगा
$10 मांगा
हाँ
वो आपको $10 दे रहा है कि 605 रुपया दे रहा है
डॉलर देगा
$10 दे रहा है ना
ठीक है
तो मेजरमेंट कब होना चाहिए 15 तारीख को या 5 तारीख को
सर मैं यही बोल रहा ना अपन बात अभी फॉरेन करेंसी
अगर मैं उससे 600 रुपया मांगू
हाँ
तो फॉरेन एक्सचेंज फ्लक्चुएशन वो बुक करेगा तो उसमें चाहे $9.85 आएगा या $10.15 आएगा वो उसका हेडेक है वो मेरे को 600 रुपया दे रहा है उस समय पे मैं 600 रुपया इनकम बुक करूंगा पर मैं उससे मांग रहा हूँ $10 अगर मैं उससे $10 मांग रहा हूँ तो मेरा इनकम $10 है $10 मैं कब रिकॉग्नाइज करूंगा 15 तारीख को जिस दिन मैं रिकॉग्नाइज करूंगा उस दिन मैं मेजर करूंगा और उस दिन के रेट पे मेजर करूंगा
ओके
फिर अगर मुझे 20 तारीख को मिले या 5 तारीख को मिले एनी अदर क्वेश्चन यस
मेजरमेंट लेंगे 15 जुलाई को हमारे इनकम एक्रू हो रही तो हम उस दिन एग्जैक्ट लेंगे लेकिन 5 जुलाई को जैसे आया था तो उस टाइम पे कन्वर्जन के लिए कोई भी अप्रॉक्सीमेट रेट ले सकते उस दिन जो आरबीआई की साइट पे अवेलेबल है
आप 5 जुलाई को आए हो बैंक का आपके बैंक ने क्या कन्वर्ट किया वो भी ले सकते हैं आरबीआई के साइट से भी ले सकते हैं कोई भी साइट से ले सकते हैं देश एक एक वेबसाइट है OANDA उससे भी ले सकते हैं और कोई वेबसाइट है बट आप जो भी वेबसाइट फॉलो करें उसको कंसिस्टेंटली फॉलो करें
जैसे
और उसका एक प्रिंट या स्क्रीनशॉट लेके रख ले एज अ प्रूफ कि मैंने ये फॉलो किया है आरबीआई की वेबसाइट फॉलो कर सकते हैं
सर
कर सकते हैं तो मेरा स्टैंडर्ड ये नहीं बोलता कि आप आरबीआई की साइट फॉलो करो या एबीसी फॉलो करो या एक्सवाईजेड फॉलो करो स्टैंडर्ड बोलता है आप जो भी फॉलो करो उसको कंसिस्टेंटली फॉलो करो, तो अगर एक ट्रांजैक्शन के लिए वो किए तो हर ट्रांजैक्शन के लिए वो करो और उसका एक प्रूफ आपके पास रख लो ताकि कोई भी आपसे पूछेगा तो आपके पास सबूत है कि मैंने ये फॉलो किया है।
सर तो 5 जुलाई को बैंक ने जो एक्चुअल कन्वर्जन किया उससे एंट्री डालेंगे और 15 जुलाई को आरबीआई पर जो रेट अवेलेबल है उससे डाल देंगे।
यस सर, यू कैन डू दैट। ओके, कंसल्टेंसी पे जाए, सिमिलर है। ओके, कंसल्टेंसी में भी बिल रेस करते हैं, डू वी रेस अ बिल? यस, सो लाइक वी राइट, वी रेस अ बिल इन डॉलर। सो एज वी spoke about 5th July and 15th July in case of conference, similarly will be the case in case of consultancy. You will book the income when you raise the bill, right? So, us din pe jo exchange rate rahega, suppose 5th July ko I raised an invoice, 15th July he made the payment, okay? So, 5th July when I raise an invoice of $10, that is when I will book a income and at a exchange rate existing on 5th of July. Okay, 15 July when I realize it, whatever is the difference between what I booked and what I realized, which is 60.5 and 61, I will book as gain or loss on foreign exchange. Same entry will take place.
Then, there were 10 days ka average nikal ke liye agar book kiya dollar ka rate to, not for 5th or 15th.
अगर सिर्फ ये ही दो ट्रांजैक्शन है, सी मैंने आपको बोला कि अगर बहुत सारे ट्रांजैक्शंस है,
बहुत सारे हैं
तो आप मंथ का एवरेज ले सकते हैं,
एवरेज लेके
और सब कुछ वो एवरेज रेट पे रिकॉर्ड कर सकते हैं उस महीने का,
इवन ट्रैवल में भी और सब में,
इवन ट्रैवल में भी आप एवरेज रेट ले सकते हैं। तो मैं 10 दिन के लिए आउटसाइड इंडिया गया, यूएस गया, तो उस समय वो 10 दिन में जो भी खर्चे हुए सब टोटल एक्सपेंसेस इन यूएसडी मल्टीप्लाइड बाय 1 एवरेज रेट एंड आई विल हैव टोटल एक्सपेंडिचर, सो आई कैन डू दैट। अगर ट्रांजैक्शंस बहुत ज़्यादा है तो आप एवरेज रेट ले सकते हैं, अगर दो ही ट्रांजैक्शन है तो उसको स्पेसिफिक रेट्स लेना पड़ेगा।